Hey guys, my name is Ich. I'm a sports videographer and I regularly post sport video edits on YouTube, more specifically documentaries, usually around the NBA and the UFC. And today I want to talk about YouTube copyright claims. More specifically, I want to talk about how to get around them and not be hit by copyright strikes. I'm going to tell you right now, there is not that many ways that this can be done. Actually, there's three ways, only three. And spoiler alert, two of those ways, if you click on this video, you're probably not going to be very excited about. But the third way though, that one you might fuck with a little bit. But anyway, before we get there, let's start by talking about who exactly is making those copyright claims and why. According to YouTube themselves, if you upload a video that contains copyright protected content, your video could get a content ID claim. These claims are automatically generated when an uploaded video matches another video or part of another video in YouTube's content ID system. So what that means is that even though YouTube is enforcing the claims, ultimately it's the copyright owners, or in this case the leagues, who make the claims in the first place. So why is that? Why are the leagues so eager to stop YouTubers from using their footage when they are already making billions of dollars? Well, that's exactly the reason. They won't allow you to use their content because it is the way they make billions of dollars. Let me explain. The biggest revenue for a league like the NBA, for example, is not ticket sales, not even pre-COVID, and it's not merchandise either, or any physical product you can think of. Their biggest revenue source is their TV deal, aka their media rights. In February 2016, the NBA announced a 9-year, $24 billion media rights deal with ESPN and Turner Sports. And when ESPN and TNT drop a casual $24 billion for media rights, they're not just paying for the right to broadcast NBA games. They're also paying for the guarantee that no one else will be able to do the same thing. In fact, exclusivity is the main reason why these rights are so expensive. And it is the NBA's job, in return for all that cash, to make sure that no one else can broadcast NBA content to the general public.
Not in my house.
So what are the consequences of receiving a content ID claim? Again, these are decided by the copyright owners themselves, aka the leagues. Copyright owners can set content ID to block uploads that match a copyrighted work they own the rights to. They can also allow the claimed content to remain on YouTube with ads, but in these cases, the advertising revenue goes to the copyright owners of the claimed content. This leads me to my first way to avoid copyright claims on YouTube, which is to not avoid them at all, actually. Just embrace them. Let's say you're making basketball edits or UFC promos just for fun or to practice your editing skills. What do you have to lose, really? Worst case scenario, your video is blocked in a few places around the world or maybe the entire world. And best case scenario, you're just not allowed to monetize your video, which is much more likely to happen than being blocked, by the way. But even if you're making videos for clout and you're chasing those hundreds of thousands of views, again, what do you really have to lose? If your video ends up being blocked worldwide, yes, technically you wasted a lot of time on that particular video. But, you know, you didn't pay for your footage, you didn't pay for your music, and I'd be willing to bet that you didn't pay for your editing software either. So if the only thing you're gambling with is your time, in my personal opinion, the risk is well worth the reward. Now, if you're in this for the money because you watch YouTube and you regularly see NBA and UFC videos made by random channels that have hundreds of thousands of views and sometimes even millions, and you assume that they are rolling in dough, let me assure you that they are not. Not from YouTube money, anyway. Just because a video is extremely popular, it doesn't mean that it's making money. For example, just have a look at my own YouTube studio where you can clearly see that my second most viewed video with over 500,000 views is not only demonetized, but it is also blocked in several countries around the world. Just to be clear, it's not because of the footage, it's because I used commercial music. Back when I made this video, my channel wasn't monetized yet, so I wasn't too concerned about those things. Anyway, my point is that YouTube is full of 500,000 views videos and 2 million views videos that haven't made a single cent for the channel that posted them. Which leads me to my second way to avoid copyright claims on YouTube, which is to simply not use professional sports content. I mean, in this day and age where complete unknowns can become famous on TV, YouTube, Instagram, or TikTok, what do you really need the NBA for?
Big fish, little fish, big fish, little fish, big fish, little fish.
There are tons of YouTube channels out there doing really well by posting high school basketball content, for example. Think about it. If you're making NBA videos, you still have to convince everyone that your channel is better than the thousands of other ones just like it. But if you go to a school that doesn't really post much sport video content, but have a basketball or a football team that is quite popular with the students, the parents, the alumni, and just the area in general, that, my friends, is a golden ticket. It's an opportunity to become the exclusive content provider for a massive and dedicated fan base that will watch every single one of your videos and constantly ask for more. Now let's talk about the third way to avoid copyright claims on YouTube, which is the way that most of you will be interested in. But first off, let me make something clear. Even though this way might end up working for you, it doesn't necessarily make it legal, and it also doesn't mean that it's going to work every time. You see, copyright claims are not made manually by someone on a computer going through YouTube all day. They are made by algorithms designed to recognize copyright-protected content. But this system is not exactly consistent. Just because you got away with using MLB footage in a video doesn't mean that you'll get away with it next time. And just because you get the green tick of approval when your upload is done, it doesn't mean that you can't get a copyright claim much later down the line. I still get new copyright claims to this day on videos that I posted 3-4 years ago. So to get away with it, the idea is to make it as hard as possible for the algorithm to recognize your footage. Some people modify the footage by making it smaller and adding random backgrounds, some flip the footage horizontally, which doesn't look so great, and some blur out the logos and watermarks. These tricks used to work a few years ago, but not so much anymore. These days, the one thing that is still very difficult for the algorithms to catch is using very short clips. So you basically want to keep your clips very short and your cuts very fast, so that the algorithm doesn't have time to figure it out. I'm talking less than 5 seconds of continuous action. Another way to help is to mix it up with footage that is not from the original broadcast. Whether it's phone footage from the stands or a different angle from the team's videographer, these rarely get in trouble with YouTube. But as I mentioned before, there is no guarantee that this works 100% of the time, and even if it does, it still doesn't make it okay. Because whether you're using broadcast footage or phone footage, or whether you're using clips from the Champions League, the EPL, or Division 2, what you are doing is always the same. You're using someone else's intellectual property without their permission. So my advice to you is, whatever you choose to do after watching this video, just own up to it. If you want to make YouTube a business, then treat it as such and don't cut corners. But if you're just chasing clout and you don't care about the rules, go for it, but accept the consequences. It's just like my favorite quote from the iconic Dolly Parton. Find out who you are, and do it on purpose. At this point, some of you might be wondering, where do YouTube's copyright strikes fit in all this? Well, the only way to get a copyright strike is if the copyright owner submits a complete and valid legal takedown request for using their copyright-protected content. And this is something that currently can't be done by an algorithm, so someone has to fill in the request manually, and it takes a few minutes. So realistically, it lessens your chances of getting a strike from big channels like the NBA or the UFC, because they would have to hire full-time staff just to keep up with all the takedown requests if they wanted to give strikes to everyone. But if you keep using their footage consistently, and they believe that you're taking business away from them for some reason, they could easily get annoyed. And if they do, all they have to do is complete a takedown request for 3 of your videos, which would take them about 30 minutes to do all up, and then boom. 1 strike, 2 strikes, 3 strikes, and you're out. For good. No warning, no excuses. So again, whatever you choose to do after watching this video, please consider the long-term consequences of your actions. On that note, thank you for watching. My name is E, and as usual, I hope I earned the privilege of your time.